Right, so kicking off with the start of the construction, just looking at the instruction sheet, in the assembly guide, in my kit at least, I don't know if it's been corrected in subsequent issues, there's a correction sheet, so it's probably worth noting that two of the parts have been reversed on the instructions. So I'll have to keep that in mind when I come to put the thing together. Because I'm doing modifications to this kit, these are the instructions for the Paragraphics interior kit, or I should say interior and exterior. But it's always worth having these to hand to compare them with the kit instructions, because at some point you'll be modifying parts and cutting holes in things and replacing some kit parts with brass parts. So you have to keep that in mind as you're going through, because otherwise it's easy to miss things. So there's a little bit of planning involved in this, you know, and I tend to build in sub-assemblies. So I'll look at each individual sub-assembly, see if there's any detail to go on it. And because I'm also light in the kit as well, some way along the line, I've got to decide, you know, where the wires are going to run for the lights and things like that. So I need to sort of figure that out as I go. So it's rare that I build anything in the order that it's shown in the instructions. I tend to end up with lots and lots of sub-assemblies that then get painted and wired up and whatever, and then come together at the end. Looking at the first part of the kit, everything's built around the base. Now, on this kit, the interior is the floor. There's no floor piece that fits inside there. So you're looking at the actual the base piece of the vehicle is the floor. And I noticed that when I first looked at this, there was quite a lot of ejector marks, these sort of circles showing all over the base. Having said that, they're raised, the majority of them are raised, which is quite unusual. Normally they're sunken and you have to fill them with some kind of filler. Now the filler I recommend, and I've been using this for years, is the Humbrol type. And the reason I've stuck with this for years is because it's the only one that really bonds properly to the styrene. And you apply a bit, leave it to go off. I normally leave it overnight and then sand it off. And it's fantastic stuff. It takes the paint well. It doesn't show up under the paint either, because essentially it's made up of powdered styrene, I think, in a solvent. So once the solvent evaporates, you're just left with more styrene. A lot of these newer fillers now that people are using, they seem to be based around something like decorator's cork, and they're water based, which, you know, potentially that's better for your health, better for the environment maybe, but they just don't bond to the plastic and they fall out. So this is the only one I really use. I've tried, I don't know, 20, 30 different fillers in the past. I occasionally use a little bit of Milliput for various jobs, but this is the main filler that I use. Luckily, though, I didn't need to fill any of this because, as I say, these were raised circles. So I've gone in with some sandpaper and sanded them flush. Now, talking about sandpaper, or I should call it really abrasive paper. I just use small sections of wet or dry. Generally use dry, depending on what I'm sanding, but occasionally use it wet. I mean, these are just random sheets that I've picked up. That's 320 grit, 240 grit. They're not too far apart. And I just use these folded up, sanding in the, you know, to get rid of the marks. What I then do to remove some of the scratches, because obviously if I was to paint that, if it's under maybe just one coat of paint, you're going to see scratches on the surface of the plastic. I go over it with a very, very fine steel wool. Now this is a brand new pack of this. This is how it comes in a cardboard tube, and you sort of tear bits off that. This is 4-0 grade, and I've got a piece here which has been used, and basically if you rub that over where you've been sanding, what it does is it polishes the plastic back to a very, very smooth finish, and that'll get rid of all those scratches. It works really, really well on styrene, and I use it on, I took off a mold line along there with it, literally just by rubbing that backwards and forwards, and it took it out. I've used it on car bodies, I've used it on all kinds of models, and it works really, really well. Another thing that I use is one of these brass brushes. Now you buy these, they normally come in a pack with maybe a steel one and a brass one. You can get them for a pound or so. I think these are actually designed for polishing spark plugs out of cars. But again, you can use these, particularly in areas where you maybe can't get in with the steel wool. And this, again, will take those scratches out. These are also very good on sort of complex shapes, like sort of figures and things like that. If you want to get rid of a fine seam on the arm of a figure, maybe, you can just buff it with this, and it'll take that seam out without destroying the detail. I've had this a couple of years now, but gradually they wear out, and they just replace it with another one. But they're cheap, and they're quite useful. Talking about tools for a second, most of my tools are sort of to hand here. Obviously, I've got various craft knives. I use these sort of X-Acto type, and I've always stuck with those for years now. I prefer these to the scalpel type, simply because the blades are heavier and they tend not to snap. I've had scalpel blades snap on me. Occasionally, you do lose the tips on them. But what I tend to have a sort of semi-worn blade, which I use for general cleanup. And then I have a much sharper one for sharper detail. And if I'm ever doing anything like sort of masking or, cutting out decals or anything, I use a brand new blade. But generally, I've got two of these blades on the go. Because I use these also for scraping a lot, so I'll scrape a seam off, and it does tend to sort of blunt the blade after a while. But I do feel a little bit more under control with this one. So this blue handle's always got the blunter blade in, and this has the sharper blade. I also use this one quite a lot, the curved one. Generally for sort of scraping on surfaces, to get rid of any kind of raised detail that I don't want. And also this chisel type, I was looking at this before. There's a big logo molded on the bottom, and I was going to clean it off, but then I realized that the center portion covers it up, so there's no need to take it off. But if this was going to be seen, I'd take that off, and I'd probably use the chisel blade to take it off and then clean it up with a bit of sandpaper. So they're the blades. I've normally got a few different pin vices on the go. There's about six there, I think. Different size drills. It's just handy to have common size drills there to just drill things out without having to change the bits all the time, particularly with these very small ones, because if you've used these, they can be quite quite fragile. And the other tools, if I just tilt the camera for a minute, you'll see that all my other tools are there on magnetic strips on the wall at the back of the bench. So, you know, I've got all these files and various cutters and all kinds of things there, tweezers, you know, razor saws, and they're handy, and I just, you know, get them down as I need them. Generally, I get by with, you know, just a handful of tools. Another useful one is this, which is the handy drill from Tamiya. It actually comes as a kit. You have to build the drill. It takes a couple of batteries in here. The good thing about this is it's geared to run at a speed which, when the drill's in use, it doesn't melt the plastic. So there's no chance of going too fast and melting the plastic. And it runs at quite a slow speed. It's brilliant. I mean, since I bought this, I've had this about 4 or 5 years now, and it's pretty much all I ever use when I need to sort of, you know, drill something out, unless I'm doing some very, very fine ones. But it's a great tool, and I'll show you that in use in a second, actually, because of what I'm doing with these parts now. So there's the base part, and there's two end pieces that fit this. However, one of them is detailed using the brass mesh provided by the Paragraphics set. So basically, I've already fitted this one. This one I had to curve slightly to get it in, and you have to drill out the mesh area that's molded into the kit part, and then remove that, and then obviously set the part in. Now, the way I do that, there's another one. If I pick this up here, there's another very fine piece there that's going to go into the front of this piece. And if you look on the end of that there, you can see that I've basically not particularly tidily, I've just done loads of random holes, which is known as chain drilling, and that's to remove the plastic that's going to go in behind that piece. So for that, once I've chain drilled it using the Tamiya drill, I've got a set of these, I don't know how you pronounce this, is it Zuron cutters? They're actually photo etch cutters, these, but I tend not to use them for cutting photo etch, and I'll explain that in a second. So I tend to use them now for very, very fine cuts, and they're handy for this because I can get in between those holes and literally snip through between the holes and work my way along, and eventually I can cut out that square section in the center, which is where I've got to clean up then to take this brass part. Now, the brass part itself, I've had to cut slightly inside the dimensions of the brass part. Let's just get rid of those little bits in there. So I end up with quite a sort of ragged looking hole, but then I then clean it up using the blade, and I'm going to clean those edges up to get them level, and by doing this and keep testing the size, I'm at the moment I'm just taking off the sharper edges of this to get it roughly to size. I marked it out with a pencil to the size that I want, so as long as I go to the pencil line. So I gradually work on this until this piece will fit over the top. But when you look through the mesh, you won't see the plastic behind it. You'll just see the tiny amount of frame on the mesh. So I'll carry on working on that in a minute. But going back to the photo etch, that's the fret that the photo etch comes on, and it's normally attached by these small tabs. And what I do is I use the curved blade to chop through. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to chop through this large piece here simply because I know what this is for, and it's not going to get lost easily. I'm not going to be using it for quite a while. This is actually the floor of the roof basket that goes on the top of the chariot. But by snipping through those small tabs around the etch, it'll free the part up. And there we go. So there's the part freed up. And what's left is these very small tabs. You can see the tab at the top there. Let me bring that in a bit closer. I'm still working with this to see what the focus of this is like. It's not too bad. I think I need to maybe do a couple of adjustments to the camera. You can see the tab on the end there. Now, you'll see, you know, people saying, well, you file that off now using files. What I actually prefer to do is to use a very fine pair of scissors, and I cut those little tabs off with the scissors. I work my way round. The only ones I can't really get to are the ones that are in, or the one that's inside that recess there. So I probably will have to take that off with the file. But I find that if I take those off using the scissors first, and then I basically use some very, very fine paper, and not too much pressure, because you don't want to bend the brass bar, but that's enough to just take that the rest of the tab off, because you can still feel the remains of the tab in the or with your fingertip. And I've seen kits in competitions where, you know, the you can still see the tab attached to the brass, which doesn't look so great. Obviously that piece there, if I find my blade again, I can probably get right in and take that little nib off with the blade. And then for that, I'd probably just pick up a small, I've got some diamond files here, and I can just get in there. It's difficult to get in there with the paper, so I use the file for that one and clean that off. I find the paper takes it off a lot easier than the files do. There you go. So that's all nicely cleaned up around the edges now. And this does have parts that need bending on it. I'm not going to do that yet though, because I'm not really at the stage of working on the basket on the top, and I've got to clean the styrene parts up first. But basically that's where we're going with that. The other thing I was going to mention was when I come to eventually stick these parts together, and obviously I'm going to be working on these for a little bit first. The type of cement I use is plastic weld. And I mean, I've used every type of cement imaginable. And I've settled on this, and I've used this for about the last 15 years or so, maybe 20 years. And it really is the best thing out there. I've used Tamiya cement. I've used all the other ones available. And they don't really compare with this. This stuff's great. I mean, it's water thin, so it does carry into the joints just by capillary action. I actually got hold of one of these. It's like a 3D printed base, just to stop it going over. So it sits in, move that over there, it sits in that base there like that, and it can't be knocked over. I've probably lost as much of that cement knocking it over as I have using it over the years. It doesn't lend itself to standing up very well. So I'd recommend that. Occasionally, if I'm going to be sticking maybe a couple of pieces of styrene sheet together to make up layers, I'll use this Revell contactor just as a smear to get it to stick together, and then I'll edge it with the plastic weld. I've never bought this. All the ones I've got are these. I've got about 8 on the go at the moment. They've all come with kits, you know, these kits you buy where you get the glue included. So I just sort of keep decanting them into the same bottles. Occasionally I'll use epoxy for particularly for the dissimilar materials, like sort of metal to plastic and things like that. And I get these, you know, they're fairly cheap, you know, because it's got the two tubes side by side. It makes, you know, it gives you the exact amount every time. And occasionally I'll use those. I go through quite a lot of CA or super glue. And this is the one I prefer, the Loctite Precision. It's the thinner stuff. It's not too thin, though. I've tried the very, very thin ones, the water thin ones, and I find that they're difficult to control and they run over the surface of the plastic and things like that. But I normally sort of put a couple of blobs on a piece of plastic card, a bit of scrap plastic, and then apply this with a cocktail stick. So again, that comes in handy when you're doing your etched brass. But in terms of, you know, the general sort of assembly of the kit, the main thing to mention here is that, you know, it's one thing follow the instructions, but you've really, when you're doing any kind of major modifications to it, i.e. lighting and adding details, you need to start thinking about how things are going to happen maybe 2 or 3 steps down the line. For instance, I was looking at this part, and obviously there's 2 headlights fit here. Now, there is a little hole there, which is to hold the pin on the back of the part. But if I'm going to light those lights, which I probably will, I may have to think about boring this out. I might have to build a headlamp assembly behind it to hold the LED. It may not be enough just to have a sort of LED poked through, you know, shining through the transparency. So again, it's all about planning ahead. I mean, where are the wires going to go for that? Given that there's no false floor in here, and this piece fits just on the front like that. Let's see if I can get that to attach there. So that piece is there. It's like, well, where am I going to run the wiring? So I may have to put some kind of conduit along the sides here, or maybe I can hide it somewhere in the center. Obviously, there's going to be an instrument panel here. There's going to be a piece in the center. I might be able to run the wires through there. Where do they go then? Well, obviously, this piece fits on the bottom. This piece fits on like so, I think. It's quite difficult to locate it on those pins. There you go. So this piece is going to be fitting on there. So there's room in here. Obviously, the axles are running through for the wheels. But there's room in here to hide all kinds of wiring. And if it's going on a diorama base, then obviously the wires are going to exit somewhere. These appear to be screw holes. I think what happens is you assemble the chassis, and then the chassis screws onto the bottom of the rest of the part. Now, I may dispense with that. I might do away with that and, you know, possibly use one of those holes to run a wire down for the lighting for the interior. So I'll have to have a look at that and see how it goes. It's one of those things you've just got to sort of think it through and decide how far you want to go for a start. I mean, some people like to build kits straight from the box. I do that occasionally. But you know, given the opportunity, particularly with sci-fi subjects where you can go mad, basically, you know, add in as much as you want, then there's a good chance that, you know, I'm going to go the whole hog with this and try and, you know, make it as lifelike as possible. What is interesting, actually, I did notice in the instruction sheet, the one in the instructions, I don't know whether it's a pre-production one, but it looks quite toy-like. It almost doesn't look like the kit that I'm building. Now, I don't know whether that's just because of the way they painted it or whatever, but I'm pretty certain it's going to look an awful lot better than that when it's done. But it almost looks like a dinky toy, which I'm sure isn't what they were thinking about. But I suspect it was probably a test shot that somebody's put together fairly quickly just to show for the instructions. And I have seen some of these builds up, which are really well detailed and well made. So hopefully it'll start to come to life. But as I go through it, each step I do, I'll try and sort of incorporate some techniques and methods of doing things and things like that. And hopefully it'll all start to make sense as it comes together. One more tool, actually, that I'm just looking at now that I didn't mention, for the folding of the brass. I've got about, I don't know, I must have about four or five different tools designed for folding etched brass, but the best one I've come across is this one, which is the one produced by Paragraphics called Photo Fold. And it actually comes as a kit. It comes as a sheet of, it's actually stainless steel, I think. It comes as a kit on a fret, and you have to cut it out and then bend it to shape. But it's by far the best I've come across. It's not complicated. It's really quick to use. You literally just slide the piece underneath this piece, and it folds up in the middle. And it literally does that, and you can go any degree of folding there, and then you slide the piece out again, and it's great. Obviously, it's got these like a toothed side as well, where you can grab smaller pieces. But in practice, I've found most of the pieces I've used have fitted under this, and I've just folded them up. That's really good. Another thing I'd recommend for photo etch is a pair of these jeweler's pliers. I got these, they're only cheap ones, but I got them from Hobbycraft, I think, about 4 or 5 years ago. I think they cost me about four or five quid. They're not the best quality. However, the reason they're good is they've got no, it looks like maybe they have there, but they haven't, it's smooth inside. They've got no serrations on the inside of the jaws. If I bring that up a bit closer, you can see it's literally just a flat surface. And so what I can do with that, I mean, for instance, if this was if I was trying to bend one of these small tabs on here, I can actually get that close up to it and bend it. They're also useful for holding small parts. So, for instance, this piece of brass here, if I was to pop that into there, I know it's not going to get damaged because they've got no serrations. They're just flat. But it means I can hold it quite close up to the edge, and then I can clean up the end using a little bit of abrasive without it bending. I mean, using photo etch, you do have to have quite a sort of delicate touch. You know, if you're somebody that, you know, you tend to squash things every time you're picking them up, maybe photo etch isn't for you. But it is one of those things that you eventually you get used to handling it. a little bit like watchmaking, really. You know, you've just got to be careful. You can't put too much pressure on everything, or you will bend it. It's certainly worth pursuing. A lot of people seem to be frightened of it, but you know, with a bit of practice, and also the paragraphics parts, they're made on quite a heavy gauge brass, because a lot of the pieces tend to be plant on pieces, you know, for sort of instrument panels and things like that. They can be just a little bit heavier than some of the brass parts you sometimes get, and they're quite easy to handle. They're quite robust. I've used etched brass from the likes of Edward and people like that, and some of it is it's wafer thin, and it, best will in the world, it's difficult to sort of handle without bending it in the wrong place. It's ideal, really. I'd say these, although they're really, really well detailed, they're also good for beginners, because it's not too difficult to use. I mean, obviously some of the parts are very, very tiny, but it doesn't follow that you have to use every part. I mean, you might use some parts off this and some of the kit parts. So it just depends how you want to do it, really. You know, you get out of it what you put into it, really, don't you? So, but anyway, I'll progress with some of this. I mean, I'm not going to go step by step with this. What I'll do is I'll build some of these components up and then show how they're put together, you know, as I go along. But there's a fair bit of work involved in cleaning out the backs of these, where this instrument panel, for instance, is going to attach. There's lots and lots of through holes in this that are going to allow light through for the instruments. And obviously the plastic behind that is going to have to be removed. I'll look at doing that and get those set up. But, you know, I'll press on with this, and I'll sort of try and do it in stages so that it's fairly obvious what I'm doing. And as I tend to use different techniques, I'll introduce that and see how we go. Okay, so thanks for that, and I'll post another one in a day or two. Okay, thanks.